over a particular type of female movie character, the femme fatale. In Beautiful But Deadly, Angus considers famous seductresses of the silver screen, those tinsel town legends who could persuade you they were capable of great passion, but could be very dangerous too. In other words, those women who could kiss and kill in equal measure. And who do we blame for this? Let's just ask Rita Hayworth.
Different than you did this morning. Clean and fresh.
Yeah, well, it's the perfume I use that makes me smell so nice.
You know, Frenchie is the real boss of Bottleneck.
Oh, well, I always like to know who's boss.
You'll find out.
Put the blame on me, boy. Put the blame on me. They once...
Your picture don't do you justice, baby.
Why don't you break his head, Jeff?
Cute.
Still wonderful, isn't it? And no dialogue. We didn't need dialogue. We had faces. There just aren't any faces like that anymore. Those imbeciles. Haven't they got any eyes? Have they forgotten what a star looks like?
Put the blame on me, boy. Put the blame on me.
Ladies, 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 so many ladies. Short, tall, fat, thin, dark, fair, hot-blooded, cold-tempered, strident, seductive, demanding, loving, cajoling, manipulative, strong, loyal, lying, decisive, thieving, cruel, giggling, victim, vamp. Hi, I'm Angus Macinnes, and I'm here in my favorite Los Angeles movie theater, an empty, dark, scary place, perfect for tonight's subject, an overview of just one type of woman that I chose from the many on offer. But what a type she is, the femme fatale in American cinema. Of all the cinematic types, my favorite is the femme fatale, the most complex, interesting, compelling, fascinating, and frightening of women. But what do we mean by femme fatale? Well, for me, she's the killer lady, a woman willing to employ all her feminine charms and wiles to get what she wants, be it fame, fortune, love, social position, or revenge. Here's an example as Claire Trevor puts it on the line as Velma in Murder, My Sweet, the 1944 version of Raymond Chandler's Farewell, My Lovely.
You've got a nice bill for a private detective.
It gets me around.
How does one get to be a private detective? You don't mind my sizing you up a little?
Most of us are ex-cops. If I worked for the DA, got fired.
Not for incompetence, surely.
But talking back, I had an interesting childhood, too, but you didn't drop it on me to get a biography.
I thought you'd like to know what Anpo said.
Yeah?
And I wanted to make it official. Shall we call this a retainer?
Let's call it a retainer. If the cops get to you, you sent for me. I didn't want to have anything to do with the case. You talked me into it. You hired me.
Do they have to know about me?
This is a sexually supercharged character who will lie, cheat, steal, deceive, defraud, and ultimately kill without hesitation. But above all, she will seduce, using her sexuality unashamedly, without compunction or guilt against her victim, in the full knowledge she will destroy him. Though she erodes his soul, to her victims, she is irresistible. Of all the templates for the modern femme fatale, there is one that stands above all the rest. Lady Macbeth's blind ambition and sensual avarice destroys a kingdom. Here's Francesca Annis as Lady Macbeth urging her hesitant husband to action from Roman Polanski's 1971 film.
Duncan comes here tonight.
Someone goes hence?
Tomorrow, as he purposes.
Never shall sun that morrow see. Your face, my Thane, is as a book where men may read strange matters. He that's coming must be provided for. And you shall put this night's great business into my dispatch.
We will speak further.
Look like the innocent flower, but be the serpent under it. Leave all the rest to me.
Leave all the rest to me. This is no mere fallen woman. No, this character is evil incarnate. She devours her own, gives no quarter, and expects none in return. Rarely can she be reformed, and she is invariably destroyed by her own actions, the wicked witch's spell rebounding on her, and all from the pen of William Shakespeare 400 years ago. Well, they do say he knew a thing or two. Playing the fatal lady even once can brand an actress for life, forever associating her with the role. But very few can turn away from the opportunity, perhaps because no actor in their right minds would pass on such an extreme role, or in film speak, a chance to eat the scenery. And of course we know who have been branded Fatale and can reel off many of their names with ease. Mary Astor, Gloria Swanson, Claudette Colbert, Betty Davis, Hedy Lamarr, Joan Crawford, Rita Hayworth, Ava Gardner, Vivian Leigh, Jane Greer. But when I looked closer at the roles these ladies have played, the less of the femme fatale I saw. Many of these fine actresses indeed played the femme, but many more didn't, and none seem to have made a habit of it. So who are the actresses that defined the role, breathed life into it, gave it substance, who made us squirm in our seats and left rational men with nightmares? With the advent of talking pictures, three actresses emerged who were forever associated with the role of the femme fatale, and with good reason, for they created templates that have been emulated, embroidered, embellished, and expanded on ever since. The first notable femme fatale of this new cinema came out of nowhere in Joseph von Sternberg's 1930 film The Blue Angel. Sternberg's Vaughn was a con. Though born in Vienna, he was raised in America. He shot the picture in Berlin in both English and German, though it was the German version that became an international hit. Its hitherto unknown star flowered overnight. Of course, I'm talking about the legendary Marlene Dietrich. Both versions featured Falling in Love Again. Here's the English one.
Falling in love again, never wanted to. What am I to do? I can't help it. Love's always been my game. Play it how I may. I was made that way. I can't help it.
In this tale of a hard-hearted woman, Dietrich plays Lola Lola, an exotic cabaret dancer. That stripper to you. Outraged by risque pictures of her, a stuffy professor, Emmanuel Rath, confronts her, but is enchanted and ensnared instead. As his infatuation deepens, he loses everything, becoming a pathetic shill for his new young wife. His downward spiral ends with him as a mad, grotesque clown who is only released from his torment by death. And all the while, Lola couldn't care less.
I can't help it.
Born December 27, 1901, Maria Magdalene Dietrich shrouded her early life in mystery, aided and abetted by the outright fabrications made by American press agents in the early 30s. For a long time, it was thought she was born Maria Magdalena von Losch in 1904, until her birth certificate was discovered by an enterprising journalist in East Germany in 1961. It turned out von Losch was her stepfather's name, her real father having died when Marlena was a child. But for Marlena's take on her early life, why don't we turn to the woman herself? This is her from a 1965 edition of Roy Plomley's Desert Island Discs.
Always something there to remind me.
Sandy Shaw. Miss Dietrich, you were born in Berlin.
Yes, I am.
I believe you come from a military family.
Mm-hmm.
And as a little girl, your upbringing was rather Spartan.
Well, I think it sounds Spartan to most of the world. I don't think it sounds Spartan to English people at all. I think the English and the Germans of that time were very similar in upbringing.
Cold bugs and all that sort of thing.
Yes, sure. And not take yourself too seriously.
What was it your first ambition to be?
Well, I don't think I had any ambition even then. I don't have any now. My ambition, or if you can call it that, my education was to be a useful human being, and that's what I've tried to be.
You did study as a concert violinist, I believe.
No, I started as a violinist, and then
yes.
They thought I could be one, and then I practiced the Bach solo sonatas. Like I always do everything in excess, I did too much of that, and I injured my fourth finger of my left hand, and in those days they put you in a cast, and when I came out of the cast, they told me that I couldn't ever last a concert, and I gave up the violin, much to the distress of my mother, because she had thought that I would be a violinist, but even then, I hated doing things in halves, and so I said, if I ever can't play a concert, I'll give it up now.
Yes. Was that a great blow to you?
Yes.
So you decided to act instead?
No, I didn't. It sort of came later. I read a lot of poetry then, and I thought, well, something was so beautiful, it was Hoffman style I read then, that it would be nice to say it up on the stage or wherever people could hear it, and this is what led me to the theater.
Did your family like the idea of your going into the theater?
No, not at all. Naturally, no family likes their children go into the theater.
This is true. You changed your name. Is Marlena
No, my name is not changed at all. My name is Mary Magdalene, and it was pulled together, the M-E-R of Mary and Magdalene from Magdalene, the L-E-N-E.
Yes.
And it was done by my mother because Mary Magdalene was too long for school and she didn't want me to be called just by the first name or the second name. So she pulled the two names together.
And there are now thousands of Marlenas all named after you.
Well, I think it's a very old, old, old German name.
How did you start in the theater? What did you go to a drama academy?
Yes, I went to the Reinhardt School.
What was your first professional appearance?
My first professional appearance was as the widow in the fifth act of The Taming of the Shrew.
That's a very tiny part, isn't it?
Yes.
And you made a number of films playing leading parts. In fact, your career was getting along very well. And then there was one engagement that gave you international success, The Blue Angel.
No, that's not true. My career was not going well at all. The Blue Angel was the very first film I made.
Mm-hmm. And you made this film in three versions?
No, in two.
Two.
In German and in English.
Now, Josef von Sternberg was a very distinguished director. Had you any inkling when you made this film that it was going to turn out to be one of the great films of the decade?
No, nobody knew this, not even the director. I don't think anybody knows when they're making a masterpiece.
The Blue Angel kicked her career into orbit, and leaving her family behind, she headed for Hollywood with her would-be Svengali von Sternberg. Her collaboration with Sternberg continued for five of her next six films, and in addition to cementing her femme fatale credentials in the films Dishonored and Shanghai Express in 1931 and Blonde Venus in 1932, also produced the uniquely exotic Dietrich look, which was remarkably masculine in tone. She appeared in male attire in all six of the pictures they made together. Dietrich made tongues wag and slacks fashionable for women. Marlena's independence of spirit, the femme fatale she played so brilliantly, rumors of her sexual ambiguity combined with her foreign origins and accent made her the Scarlet Woman of the 1930s. The crusade launched by the National Legion of Decency in concert with another hysterical crusade led by William Randolph Hearst branded Dietrich box office poison, along with Mae West, Katharine Hepburn, and Fred Astaire. She was in good company. But Dietrich was more resilient than her detractors, and she bounced back opposite Jimmy Stewart in the 1939 hit Destry Rides Again, playing the saloon chanteuse Frenchie, a thinly disguised version of Lola from The Blue Angel. Here she is belting out See what the boys in the back room will have.
See what the boys in the back room will have, and tell them I'm having the same. Go see what the boys in the back room will have, and give them the poison they name. And when I die, don't spend my money on flowers and my picture in a frame. Just see what the boys in the back room will have, and tell them I sigh, and tell them I cry, and tell them I died of the same.
Despite the harassment she was subjected to in America, Dietrich was clearly alarmed by events at home. When she turned down a personal offer from Hitler, her films were banned in Germany. So she became an American citizen, entertained the troops overseas, sold war bonds, and made anti-Nazi radio broadcasts in German, all the while continuing to make movies. It was not surprising she was awarded the Freedom Medal for meeting a grueling schedule of performances under battle conditions, despite risk to her life, and being named Chevalier of the French Legion of Honor. She made a dozen or so pictures during the 40s, three of them opposite John Wayne, The Seven Sinners in 1940, Pittsburgh in 1942, and The Spoilers that same year. Now in her mid-40s, the plum roles were fewer, though she did revisit her Dark Lady. Here she is in Billy Wilder's 1948 espionage satire, Foreign Affair.
Tell me, Colonel, are you that wonderful Colonel Plummer?
That's me. Only most of the time they call me Delicious.
Colonel, if I could come to your office tomorrow sometime, when you're not too busy.
Miss von Schlutow, I've become a grandfather today. Let's not be silly. She's all yours.
Can they take me by my apartment so I can change?
I guess so.
Come on, boys.
The two worked together again on Witness for the Prosecution in 57, and she finished her career in Orson Welles' 1958 masterwork, A Touch of Evil, delivering one of the most memorable closing lines in film history.
Isn't somebody going to come and take him away?
Yeah, in just a few minutes. You really liked him, didn't you?
The cop did. The one who killed him. He loved him.
Well, Hank was a great detective, all right.
And a lousy cop.
Is that all you have to say for him?
He was some kind of a man. What does it matter what you say about people?
Reinventing herself in the 50s as a cabaret and recording star, she played to full houses worldwide. Dietrich had come full circle, and what a voice she had. As Dietrich's star soared through the 30s, so the Depression gripped America. Widespread unemployment and the lack of an effective social safety net generated a deep cynicism that was reflected in the work of crime writers like Dashiell Hammett, Raymond Chandler, and Cornell Woolrich, and the songs of Pete Seeger and Woody Guthrie. In film, this mood fused with a dark, brooding naturalism brought to American screens by the flood of European filmmakers fleeing Nazi persecution. Film noir gave dozens of young, talented actresses an opportunity to break the mold in complex, challenging roles and to redefine the femme fatale character. The girl next door became the monster on the mattress. Two actresses who benefited from this new style were Barbara Stanwyck and Joan Sterndale Bennett. Together, they accounted for some of the most memorable characterizations of the deadly lady the screen has given us. Barbara Stanwyck was born Ruby Stevens in Brooklyn, New York, in July 1907, and orphaned 4 years later. The poverty and toughness of the Brooklyn streets seeped into her. An apprenticeship dancing in speakeasies in her teens, then the Ziegfeld Chorus, allowed her access to the legitimate theater, and in 1926 she landed the lead role in The Noose on Broadway, and the following year appeared in her first film, The Silent Broadway Nights. She married comedian Frankie Faye, and armed with Hollywood contracts, the two headed west. Her performance in Ladies of Leisure, directed by Frank Capra, made her a star in 1930, the same year as Dietrich. In Capra, Stanwyck found her Sternberg, and under his guidance, her career took a decided turn for the better as he stripped away the false glamour and toughness and replaced it with an unquestioned honesty. Her reputation as a hard-working professional won her admiration and popularity throughout the industry, as many would bear witness. Although Frank Capra had a complex analysis of her talent when he talked in 1981 to BBC Radio's Roy Pickard.
During the 30s, I remember in your book a very interesting thing when you said that Barbara Stanwyck was so marvellous on the first take, if I remember rightly, and then afterwards it became more difficult for her if she didn't get it right. Weren't there many actresses like that?
No, and especially stage actresses, because they rehearse a great deal, and they rehearse days, weeks before they actually perform before an audience. So rehearsal to them is nothing new, and it's something new, and they get something new out of every rehearsal, you know. So to find the girl, she was very young. She was say 18, and a chorus girl, and what she had been in one show. So she did not have a great deal of experience, but she did have this fire within her that wanted it burning, and she was kind of silent and sullen all the time. But when she started, it opened up, you know, and I found that she'd leave her very best take in the dressing room. So I said, how can I do this? I don't. This girl is definitely gets worse. As she third, second take is worse than the first, and third, and fourth, and finally she's flat. She's giving it all out, you know. And so I said, well, I don't know how we can do this. Well, I could do anything I wanted to. That was the nice thing about being at Columbia. So I asked for two more cameras, and I shot with three cameras on her. And it's hard, but I went through it. So now what I was trying to do was get her in the close shots and the medium shots in the first take. Not take it in the long take, because I should leave it. Nothing, and then move back. Just reverse the normal, which was long shot, medium shot, close-ups. Now I'd shoot the close-ups first and pull back. And they made a lot of actors very, very, very angry because they couldn't rehearse with her. I'd rehearse with them all day long. I didn't even rehearse, but they couldn't rehearse with her.
Barbara Stanwyck attacked virtually any role in any genre with gusto, her only criteria being that the character had the scope to contain her voracious personality. She played comedy, broad and subtle, drama contained and unrestrained, in cheesy westerns and intense contemporary melodramas. She was victor and vanquished, noble and base by turns. She had this weird capacity to slide in a heartbeat from dewy, soft sensuality into a bullet-spraying killer, the toughest dame on the block. And you believed her, or else. This is her ruthless Lily Powers, an early incarnation of her femme fatale, sleeping her way to the top of a bank, leaving ruined lives, suicides, and murder in her wake, in the 1933 film Babyface.
Say, I like it here. How about a job?
Don't tell me in this great big building there ain't some place for me.
Have you had any experience?
Plenty. I'd rather wait in there. I hate crowds. Don't you?
The boss won't be back for an hour.
Well, then why don't we go in and talk this over?
Her toughness on film translated into her personal life. She became one of the first stars to gain freedom from the studios and manage her own affairs. In 1944, the U.S. Internal Revenue Service announced that she was the highest paid woman in America. She had another stab at the femme fatale character as Jean Harrington in 1941's The Lady Eve, a comedy providing one of those rare instances where the femme fatale is reformed and makes good in the end. Here she is seducing a witless Henry Fonda.
How was everything up the Amazon?
All right, thank you.
Are you always going to be interested in snakes?
Well, snakes are my life.
What a life.
I suppose it does sound sort of silly. I mean, I suppose I should have married, settled down. I imagine my father always wanted me to. As a matter of fact, he's told me so rather plainly. I just never cared for the brewing business.
Oh, you say that's why you've never married?
No, it's just I've never met her. I suppose she's around somewhere in the world.
It would be too bad if you never bumped into each other.
Well.
But until 1944's Double Indemnity, her audiences didn't know just how tough, dangerous, and downright nasty she could be. In this great noir classic, she plays the vicious seductress Phyllis Dietrichson, who seduces insurance salesman Fred McMurray to write a double indemnity policy for her husband, then convinces the hapless sucker to murder him, then turns on the mug. This is her spinning her web.
I want to ask you something, Walter. Could I get an accident policy for him without bothering him at all?
How's that again?
It would make it easier for you, too. You wouldn't even have to talk to him. I have a little allowance of my own. I could pay for it, and he needn't know anything about it.
Why shouldn't he know?
Because he doesn't want accident insurance. He's superstitious about it.
A lot of people are. It's funny, isn't it?
If there was a way to get it like that, all the worry would be over. See what I mean, Walter?
Sure, I got good eyesight. You mean you want him to have the policy without him knowing it? And that means without the insurance company knowing that he doesn't know it. That's a setup, isn't it?
It all ends in tears, of course, and death. Stanwyck went on to play three more great femme fatales in 1946's The Strange Love of Martha Ivers, The File on Thelma Jordan in 1949, and as the scheming Kathy Ferguson in 1957's Crime of Passion, her last outing as the dangerous dame. As age curtailed her choice of roles, she shifted to television in the early 60s with the Barbara Stanwyck Show, The Big Valley, The Thornbirds, and The Colbys, winning three Emmys to boot. Though nominated for four Academy Awards, she was always the bridesmaid. Compensation came in 1981 when she received an honorary Oscar as an artist of impeccable grace and beauty, a dedicated actress, and one of the great ladies of Hollywood. The other film noir diva who made her fatale mark in several films was Joan Sterndale Bennett. In contrast to Stanwyck, she was born into a theatrical family, February the 7th, 1910, in Palisades, New Jersey. After a privileged private education in Connecticut and finishing school in Versailles, she followed her parents into the theater. Joan and her sisters Constance and Barbara made their film debut in bit parts in their father Richard's 1916 silent, The Valley of Decision, and she made her stage debut in 1928. A year later, she was in Hollywood, the star of Bulldog Drummond opposite Ronald Coleman. From there, she went on as a strong leading lady in both comedy and drama. But she was branded femme fatale in Fritz Lang's Woman in the Window in 1945, playing Alice Reed, a classic femme fatale in a classic film noir opposite Edward G. Robinson. In this dark tale, she corrupts Robinson, turning a gentle psychology professor into a killer. Let's listen.
I couldn't have dropped that much. You did pose for it, didn't you? Well, then my admiration for the artist is doubled. It's not only a good painting, it's also you.
You know that so quickly?
I don't know it. I only know that if I were a painter and had done this of you, I'd be very happy about it. Is it yours?
No. I wish it were. Then I wouldn't have to come over here every so often to watch people's faces.
Is that what you do?
Now and then.
when I'm lonely.
Tonight?
I was alone. I don't like to be.
But did you watch my face?
Oh, yes.
That same year, she descended once again into the pit with Lang and Robinson in Scarlet Street. Here's Kitty March on the make.
Don't cry, Kitty. Please don't cry.
I'm not crying, you fool. I'm laughing.
Kitty.
Oh, you idiot. How can a man be so dumb?
Kitty.
Laugh in your face ever since I first met you. You're old and ugly, and I'm sick of you. Sick, sick, sick.
Kitty, for heaven's sake.
You killed Johnny? I'd like to see you try. Why, he'd break every bone in your body. He's a man. You want to marry me? You? Get out of here. Get out. Get away from me. Chris. Chris, get away from me. Chris.
A gentle part-time painter, Edward G., is corrupted by Bennett, who ruins him, but ultimately pays with her life. Joan Bennett went on to play many diverse roles, including a long stint in the TV series Dark Shadows, but never revisited the Dark Lady. Still, once a femme, always a femme. In Dietrich, Stanwyck, and Bennett, the die was cast for the femme fatale, and many more would follow. And it was in film noir that the fullest expression of this character would continue, throwing up a raft of fine actresses playing variations of the femme, although most only once or twice. These included Gail Russell, Claire Trevor, Gloria Graham, Jan Sterling, Ida Lupino, Veronica Lake. It's a long list and could get longer, but another good example of the one-off femme fatale is Jane Greer, who unfolded as the dark flower in the great noir classic from director Jacques Tourneur, Out of the Past, whose British title was Build My Gallows High. In a moment we will hear her as the grasping Kathy Moffat entrapping a willing Robert Mitchum. But first, this is her talking about the movie.
Jacques Tourneur, at that time, didn't speak English very well. And he, in speaking of the part, he said to me, "Do you know the word impassive?" And I said, "Yes, I know that word." He says, "That's what I want, impassive." I said, "Yes, I know I can do that." He says, "No big eyes. No big eyes. No big eyes." Well, I did throw in a few big eyes anyway. I couldn't help myself. But anyway, I tried not to. And he said, "First half, good girl. Last half, bad girl." That's all I needed to know. And that was the direction. And then he stuck to that. And it was wonderful. It was easy for me, too, because I knew what I was doing. I just had to figure out when that half was. No, I knew when I killed my first victim.
You wouldn't have killed him. You would have beaten him up and thrown him out.
You didn't have to do it.
You wouldn't have killed him. He'd have been against us, gone to wit.
Bob Mitchum was a lovely, lovely man. He really looked after me. I mean, what did I know? You know, if my clothes didn't fit right, I didn't care. I got this great part. He would say, Why is that hanging on her? Look at her. I mean, why? Can't somebody come and bring a needle and thread here and get that to fit her right, you know? Or, what is that? That's not on her head right, or her hair. You know, he would look after me and say, "You have to defend yourself. Ask for makeup." Well, I'd go around, you know, with hardly any, you know, at the end of the day, if it was chewed off, it was chewed off, you know. Come in here and check her, you know. And he was wonderful. It was just great.
Born Betty Jane Greer on September 9th, 1924 in Washington, D.C., she was pushed by her ambitious mother into beauty and talent contests, modeling professionally at age 12. It was a World War II recruiting poster with Greer in a WAC uniform that caught the eye of the salacious Howard Hughes. He promptly signed her to a film contract, and she played a number of leads before retiring to raise a family in 1953. She did return to the screen in later life in a number of supporting roles, including as a regular on the TV series Falcon Crest. There were not a few surprises when I looked closely at this genre and its trademark femme fatales. The first was Mary Astor as Bridget O'Shaughnessy opposite Bogart in one of my favorite films, John Huston's 1941 masterpiece, The Maltese Falcon. Here's an example of the verbal dance between her and Bogey.
Oh, I'm so alone, afraid. I've got nobody to help me if you won't help me. Be generous, Mr. Spade. You're brave. You're strong. You can spare me some of that courage and strength, surely. Help me, Mr. Spade. I need help so badly. I've no right to ask you. I know I haven't, but I do ask you. Help me.
You won't need much of anybody's help. You're good. Chiefly your eyes, I think, and that throb you get in your voice when you say things like, be generous, Mr. Spade.
I deserve that. But the lie was in the way I said it. Not at all in what I said. It's my own fault if you can't believe me now.
Now you are dangerous.
Mary Astor is a name to conjure with. She was one of the few big silent stars to successfully make the transition to talkies, where her star continued to rise despite a salacious public divorce in 1936. Born May 3, 1906, she debuted in film in 1922 in The Man Who Played God and capped her 43-year career with Hush, Hush, Sweet Charlotte in 1965. But the strangest journey an actress ever made was when Gloria Swanson went from queen of the silent screen and fashion icon in the 20s to the obscurity of retirement in the 1930s to Academy Award nomination in 1950 for her ironic portrayal of Norma Desmond, a faded, reclusive, deluded star of the silent screen in Billy Wilder's poison note to Hollywood, Sunset Boulevard. Her performance was of another time. I doubt any other actor could have given us such a bittersweet take on the femme fatale character.
Lady, you got the wrong man. I had some trouble with my car, flat tire. I pulled into your garage until I could get a spare. I thought this was an empty house.
It is not. Get out.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry you lost your friend. And I don't think red is the right color. Wait a minute, haven't I seen you before? I know your face.
Get out, or shall I call my servant?
You're Norma Desmond. Used to be in silent pictures. Used to be big.
I am big. It's the pictures that got small.
Though completely mad, Norma is clearly a thoroughbred femme fatale. She is a caustic arch-manipulator, brim full of the seven deadly sins. And as the dregs of her sanity crumble under the onslaught of reality, she shoots poor, stupid William Holden 6 times in the back, fatally. Brilliant typecasting out of left field for the master Billy Wilder. Here she is talking about the impact the film had on the Hollywood community in a program called The Lively Arts on the World Service in 1972.
It was a very curious effect it had on the profession. The Hollywood people, because they thought here, that you see, a lot of people thought it was autobiographical. It was about as autobiographical as taking your life and saying it's mine. I've never been a recluse. God knows I'm not. No one's floating in my pool having been shot. I don't live in the past. I hate talking about it. I'm much more interested in now and tomorrow. A lot of people thought that, Norma Desmond was really somebody in our business. I never knew anyone like that. We've all heard that Garbo, I want to go home, I want to be alone, I am so tired. But I don't know anyone that acted like Norma, and the fact that I had been in talking pictures, and she had never, Norma Desmond, and had never made a talking picture, and how people could imagine it was my life, but they did, even those people in the profession. Lots of them said, well, if she can come back after 10 years, why can't we? This took in directors, producers, and actors. I want you to know that the effect, the night that we ran it at the Paramount studio, room for about 300 or 400 people, the effect of that picture on that audience was the most extraordinary thing I have ever experienced. And God knows my experience of coming back from France in 1925, having almost died over there and having made Madame Saint-Jean and, you know, marrying a marquis, this was something. It was like the prodigal returning and Lazarus coming back out of the grave and Cinderella marrying the prince. And that was enough to really be the top thing in my life. But I think, in a way, this was even stranger because when it was over, the silence was so thunderous that you could hear your own heartbeat, you know, in your head. It was incredible for, I should think, a good long 5 seconds. And then they carried on like they were insane. And as I came up the aisle, people grabbed me, hugged me, darlinged me, people who a year before wouldn't have given me a crust of bread if I'd stood at their back door.
Talk about careers. Born Gloria Josephine May Swenson on March 27, 1897, in Chicago of Swedish parents, she died Gloria Swanson April 4, 1983. She worked on and off in the film industry for 59 of those 86 years. La Swanson. Been there, done that, and she got the T-shirt. Trolling through the archives, I realize there are many actresses who spring to mind as classic femme fatales, and they may have had close brushes with the notorious lady, but they are never deep down inside the Black Widow. They may be strong, decisive, nasty at times, mad as hatters at others, but rarely are they cunning, scheming criminals, leaving death and destruction in their wake. They're remarkable actresses who carved out memorable characters with aplomb, most obviously Betty Davis, Ava Gardner, Kate Hepburn, Dorothy L'Amour, Vivian Leigh, Anne Sheridan, Rita Hayworth, Lauren Bacall, Hedy Lamarr, Jane Russell, and yes, even Joan Crawford. Many could be nastier than a poke in the eye with a sharp stick, but I just don't buy them as dyed-in-the-wool femme fatales. Now a weird thing happened. Taste and style changed. The war was over, Eisenhower was president, and America, in the grip of the Cold War, was prosperous, if a little dull. The dark days of the Depression had lifted for everyone except my father, and the bright hope of the future eclipsed the noir genre. We began to get lovelies like Doris Day, Elizabeth Taylor, Mitzi Gaynor, Marilyn Monroe, and Julie Andrews gracing our screens. Many were strong leading ladies. Some were sex goddesses. Others were sweet innocents. None, not even the sumptuous Cleopatra, would I describe as a true femme fatale. The lady seems to have vanished. The death of John F. Kennedy and the upheavals of the Vietnam War put paid to that pretty quick.
Viet Cong are believed to be holed up about a half a block away from this spot.
It appears as though something has happened in the motorcade route. Something, I repeat, has happened in the motorcade route.
The message is very simple. Think for yourself and question authority.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed.
Jack Russell, NBC News, Saigon.
With America in turmoil, the ground was ripe for the resurrection of darker, more complex material. And in 1967, she rose from her crypt in the form of Faye Dunaway as Bonnie Parker. Born an army brat on January 14, 1941, Dunaway joined the Lincoln Center repertory after college and got her first break in films with The Happening in 1967, followed by Bonnie and Clyde that same year.
And rent them a nice little flat.
About the third night, they're invited to fight by a subgun's rat-a-tat-tat. Someday, they'll go down together. They'll bury them side by side. To few, it'll be grief. To the law, a relief. But it's death for Bonnie and Clyde.
You know what you done there? You told my story. You told my whole story right there, right there. One time I told you I was gonna make you somebody, that's what you done for me. You made me somebody they gonna remember.
Bonnie and Clyde confirmed the stardom of Gene Hackman, made a superstar of Warren Beatty, and revealed Faye Dunaway as one of the great latter-day femme fatales. Dunaway made the consummate hyper-bitch her own and rendered variations on the theme in The Thomas Crown Affair in 1968, Little Big Man in 1970, Chinatown in 74, and Network in 76. Dunaway had the touch. These five films garnered a total of 31 Academy Award nominations and won 7. Including Best Actress for Faye in Network. Miss Dunaway's contemporaries and inheritors are many and varied, but inevitably as difficult to categorize as their predecessors. What about Claire Bloom, Jane Fonda, Vanessa Redgrave, Jessica Lange, or Meryl Streep? Or later, Susan Sarandon, Michelle Pfeiffer, Gina Davis, Sigourney Weaver, Julia Roberts, Jodie Foster, Cher, Nicole Kidman, Gwyneth Paltrow or Annette Bening. These unquestionably talented artists are like many before them in not having taken up the dark scarlet line cloak of the femme fatale. They have played women who are strong, weak, helpful, helpless, smart and stupid, some long-suffering, some self-sacrificing, some self-serving. But all their characters are imbued with a moral...
Can I ask you something?
What?
Why don't you have a date tonight, a Saturday night?
I did have a date. I stood him up. That was the phone call I made. Does that make you feel good?
Doesn't make me feel bad.
So where's your wife?
Where's my wife? My wife is in the country with her parents visiting on the weekend.
And you're here with a strange girl being a naughty boy?
I don't think having dinner with anybody's a crime.
Not yet.
In this sordid, disturbing, and steamy take on infidelity, Close's powerful performance as Alex Forrest struck fear in the heart of the wandering male. So arresting was her portrayal of this violently obsessive woman, she completely left-footed the studio executives, who thought her character would hold the audience's sympathy. Wrong again, boys. In her climactic fight with the much-put-upon Michael Douglas, the audience actually chanted, "Kill the bitch!" A native of Greenwich, Connecticut, Glenn had an exotic childhood, growing up in Africa and Switzerland. Her father had a clinic in the Belgian Congo. After an apprenticeship in the New York theater, she made her film debut in 1982's The World According to Garp, but made every femme fatale watcher sit up and notice with fatal attraction. This is her delivering a warning.
He's so sad. You know that, Alex? Lonely and very sad.
Don't you ever pity me,
I'll pity
smug
you.
Bastard.
I'll pity you, but you're sick.
Why? Because I won't allow you to treat me like some slut you can just bang a couple of times and throw in the garbage. I'm going to be the mother of your child. I want a little respect.
You want respect?
What are you doing? Please don't go. I didn't mean it. Please, I'm sorry. I'll tell your wife.
You tell my wife, I'll kill you.
Miss Close presented another femme in the deliciously corrupt Marquise de Merteuil, who wages on the virginity of a young Uma Thurman with the equally debauched John Malkovich in the exquisite 1988 period piece Dangerous Liaisons, a deep-seated evil camouflaged by an astonishing beauty. Listen, she sounds so ordinary.
Do you know why I summoned you here this evening?
I'd hoped it might be for the pleasure of my company.
I need you to carry out an heroic enterprise. You remember when Bastide left me?
Yes.
Went off with that fat mistress of yours whose name escapes me.
Yes, yes.
No one has ever done that to me before, or to you, I suspect.
I was quite relieved to be rid of her, frankly.
No, you weren't. For some years now, Bastide has been searching for a wife. He was always unshakably prejudiced in favor of convent education, and now he's found the ideal candidate.
Cécile Vallange.
Very good.
More whimsically, she took the femme fatale character to its extremes as the wholly evil Cruella de Vil in Disney's 1996 live-action 101 Dalmatians and the recent sequel. She clearly had a ball doing them. Now, something wicked this way comes, and her name is Sharon Stone. A small-town girl from Meadville, Pennsylvania, a beauty contest winner who became a model and who segued her way into film via extra work in Woody Allen's Stardust Memories in 1980. She got her break opposite Arnie Schwarzenegger in Paul Verhoeven's 1990 sci-fi flick Total Recall. Liking what he saw, Verhoeven gave her the lead in his next picture, Basic Instinct. In this convoluted 1992 thriller, Stone plays Catherine Trammell, a crime writer who becomes a suspect when her plots begin to happen in real life. A pervasive sense of amorality runs through the film as Stone's super-sexual character sucks the pursuing cop into her orbit. And yes, regirding his loins again is Michael Douglas. Is this actor obsessive about roles involving confrontations with femme fatales?
I'm still intrigued about the gray area in people. I think that there is an element of violence in all of us. There's a sexuality in all of us. And we learn to sublimate it through society. But when you find a good story and a character that allows you to at least expose or express those areas, I enjoy it, and I think it can hopefully make for some good filmmaking.
Michael Douglas speaking in 1992 at the time of the release of Basic Instinct. His co-star, Sharon Stone, had her say at the time, too, about her character, Catherine Trammell.
You have to go so far out on a limb to play Catherine. You must be ultimately as devious as you can be. I must seduce him with my mind. I must seduce him with my sexuality. I have to weave this web that he cannot pull himself out of. I have to go to every extreme place to pull him in and to psychologically weave him into my mysterious web of darkness.
You working on another book?
Yes, I am.
It must really be something, making stuff up all the time.
Yeah, it teaches you to lie.
How's that?
You make stuff up. It has to be believable. It's called suspension of disbelief.
I like that. Suspension of disbelief.
What's your new book about?
A detective. He falls for the wrong woman.
What happens?
She kills him. For her, her soul is so dark and so damaged. And the walls of, once again, I'm going to say, is the boundaries of where to go are all broken down so that everything comes and goes. There's so much darkness in there that the ultimate bonding in her soul is a very dark thing. When it's what Catherine and Nick have, which is this dark, dark place, it's very difficult to find someone to play with. So when they find their playmate, it's a really big, big thing. It's like the world has opened up and they're not alone, finally.
Sharon Stone, telling it like it is when you get inside the mind of a femme fatale. Sharon brought another femme to life in Martin Scorsese's 1995 Vegas crime saga, Casino. Stone's Ginger McKenna is as rapacious and manipulative as they come in this nasty film. You want nightmares? Sharon will oblige. The new independent cinema has bombarded us with the new noir or new naturalism. Gritty films that kick us in the guts, shoving our imaginations over the edge. Pulp Fiction, Quentin Tarantino's 1995 follow-up to his cult hit Reservoir Dogs, revived the femme dangereuse. Uma Thurman is a mobster's decadent wife who puts John Travolta in a real fix. Thurman here is a dark lady, but more dangerous than fatal. The moral vacuum may be there, but the intention isn't. Of all the recent incarnations of the femme fatale, one is so out of place she can't be ignored. Many may be appalled, but I was charmed by her performance as Susan in the 1985 mystery thriller Desperately Seeking Susan, and she gave a convincing homage to the femme fatales of the past as the vampy Breathless Mahoney in 1990's Dick Tracy. She then topped them all in the 1997 musical Evita. Yes, I'm talking about Madonna, the pop star Madonna. From the adroit manipulation of her public image, there's not a little of the femme fatale in the real-life Madonna. Love her or loathe her, this babe's got brains, beauty, boobs, and a bazillion in the bank, and can do whatever she likes. So that's it for now. Sadly, we've been able to look at too few of these fascinating characters. What is the enduring fascination with this archetype, the femme fatale? Well, I guess that's what archetype means. It just is. So this woman will always be filmed. I'll leave you with Madonna's Evita, crooning to the crowd, weaving her web in song.